I picked a pot so that's just about the right size for it, so I don't have packing peanuts today, and this is for just fun purposes anyway. We're gonna pot it just for fun. But if you see there, I'm gonna put the edge of the cut end at the back of the pot. And I'm gonna give it about 3 inches or 2.5 inches of space in front of the lead growth, so the new growth here. And that'll give it about maybe, depending on where you live or your conditions, in Southern California, this bark lasts for about maybe a year, you know, maybe 2 years. So this is about 2 years of growing into this pot. At that point, it's gonna either climb out of the pot like it did last time, or within 2 years, mix goes bad anyway. It decomposes, so you gotta kinda have to repot plants, cattleyas, or orchids in general, pretty much 2 years on this bark stuff. So given that amount of space, that seems right. A couple inches in front of the lead growth. You don't wanna go bigger. It's okay to make a smaller pot. I mean, it's okay to repot in a smaller pot.
Yeah.
But what you don't wanna do is put in a big 10-inch pot. The biggest problem that people have when they're repotting orchids, whether it's cattleyas or phalaenopsis or any orchid, is just over-potting it, thinking that, you know, there's room to grow and we're gonna put in a big pot. What happens is the bigger the pot, the more moisture it holds onto. So what happens is you get a big sopping wet of media right in the center of the pot. And there, what happens is that you get rot. So you get root rot. So by slightly under-potting the plant, or at least giving a couple inches there, you're not gonna get this, least likely to get root rot. You know, again, they grow on the surface of the bark, basically, or surface of the trees. You know, they're air plants. So I'm gonna just position it. There's a little, you know, a couple inches down right there, you can see there, the lip of this pot. So I'm gonna just place it right about there, and then you just fill it in.
Do you wanna hold the plant slightly horizontally?
Exactly. You want the plant basically horizontal to the surface of how you're gonna pot it. So it might be leaning forward, that's okay. What you can do, we'll work on that once we fill it in, but you don't wanna pot it up like this because it's gonna climb out of the pot. Again, they grow basically on the surface of the tree, you know, bark or limbs. So you wanna let it grow horizontal. So try to keep it as horizontal as you can in the pot. Don't pot it up like this, and try not to bury it either when you try to bury it down. What happens if you plant it like this, you're gonna bury the eyes.
Yeah.
And you could rot out the eyes too, or the eyes will start going into the bark and they come up like this. So try to keep it as horizontal as you can. So just, you know, all you gotta do is just fill in around it. And they're gonna kill me because I gotta clean up this mess. And I'm just, you know, doing this for them. And I just use my thumb to pressure, you know, push the bark around the plant. And I just work around and around. Now I normally would have what they call a potting stick, and unfortunately I didn't bring it tonight. I had all this stuff to bring. But you would have a potting stick, and when I first started out, I just used an old hammer handle. The head of it kind of flew off.
Yeah.
You probably broke a window. And I just used the end of the hammer handle. And but at Stewart's and Armacost, they had stainless steel or aluminum. And that, you know, I have that at home and I forgot to bring it, but aluminum or a metal thing is that you can clean it. With a hammer handle, you can't, you know, not really. But what you can do with the stainless steel potting tool is that you can clean it with Fizan too. So I would normally do that. But the old adage was, now some people don't do this. Some people basically just, you can pot it up like this. You don't need a potting stick really. And you could gently force the bark with your thumb into it. But what the guys at Armacost and Stewart's would do is they would get the potting stick and they would shove it down so that it'd be so tight that when you pick up the plant, you could, and I still do that. I still pack it in there pretty tight so that when it's finally potted, I can lift the plant up by the plant. I don't have to pick it up with a pot. It's in there pretty tight. And the reason I like that, and the reason why they did that, is because you don't want the plant to jiggle in the pot. What happens is that day-to-day wind and air and anything else that could jiggle the plant disturbs the root growth, or roots from going into the potting mix. If you can minimize that, that's great. And so that's why they jam in there pretty tight. But nowadays, you know, you don't have to do that. You just pack in there pretty tight, use your hands, and I use a rhizome clip. These are made of aluminum. And once I'm done, I'll just place a rhizome clip over the top of the rhizome. And right now it's in there pretty tight. The plant is, I mean, I don't have to really go and slam this in there. But you can see it's planted fairly, it's, you know, horizontal to the mix.
Did you make the clips or can you buy them?
No, you can buy these things. What is it? Not Home Depot. If you go on like Orchids Class, Orchid Mall. There's a thing on the internet called Orchid Mall, and there's a list of classified ads and other things and name of orchid vendors. There's also a list of orchid supplies. So they give you a whole list of orchid supply companies. And there's one up in, I think, I want to say like Camarillo or something like that, California, or tropical orchid, tropical plant. You can just buy it in quantity. So you could buy the rhizome clips in quantity, you could buy fertilizer in quantity, things like that. With a lot of the orchid companies like Stewart's gone, you know, there really isn't a place where you can go in, you know, or a retail place. But if you go on the internet, you can find a lot of these things, orchid supply places. So, you know, there you go.
Looks nice.
Now, one thing I always say is that I already have the old tag there. And so what I do is I keep the old tag. And take my gloves off because I can't write my gloves. People have, you can have the tag that sticks in the pot, or I like these tags that you wire on. I prefer the wire-on tags because the biggest problem that everybody has is that, or if you go on Facebook or think, oh, here's a picture of my noid. What's a noid? You know, not identification. No identification. So, and I hate that myself. When you have a flower and, oh God, it's so beautiful, but I don't know what it is. And not to mention if you want to enter it for shows or you want to enter for judging, you don't know what it is. You can't even know what it is. So always label your plant. So here's the label. And I'm going to write on my new tag, Cattleya Nancy, off 640. And I'm gonna write the date that I repotted, so 08, today's the 15th, right?
August 15th, 17.
So I'm gonna write the date I repotted it, and I'm gonna save that tag. And, you know, I wired it, copper wire, it doesn't rust or it doesn't break down. Copper just doesn't decompose like steel does. And, and I just wired on to the back of the plant. Now, I put it on near the, I wired on near the base mm-hmm. of the rhizome, because in the open, sometimes people would wire it up here, near the juncture of the leaf axle and the subo. What happens if, you know, as the plant gets older, you start losing leaves. It's not really a deciduous plant, but as the plant gets older, you get leafless bulbs. And if you wire it on here, well, and the leaf falls off, your tag falls off. So this is something that Carter and Holmes did, and this is what Gene Quacker did, that he showed me. He said, wire it on down here, because it'll never fall off unless this thing whole thing rots off. And if that's the case, you're doing something wrong. So wire it on there, and I think that was a smart idea. And then I'll go back to my back bulb and see what I have here. Well, you know, I'm gonna cut off some of this stuff here.
Oh, I do that too.
Oops. And now something like this actually is in pretty good shape for a back bulb, really. It might not look like much, but I could just pot it up right now in bark, and it'll probably pop a dormant eye. But if you got a really sad plant that you don't see a lot of dormant eyes on, there's an old technique, I mean, if you call it sphag and bag. You can take a plastic bag, like a, you know, a Ziploc bag. And get some New Zealand sphagnum moss, or some good, you know, clean sphagnum moss, and dampen it. And then, you know, wash this all off. Make sure this is clean first. You know, I would take a hose and wash all the old bark off. Make sure that it's clean. And then place the plant in the plastic bag with the moist sphagnum. And then put it in a shady place. And what happens in a couple months, or it may take, you know, a month, 2 months, depending on the plant, it'll pop an eye. One of these eyes back here, a dormant eye may pop, and when it starts putting out new growth, then you can just pot it up. Yeah. It's a great way of growing back bulbs.
Do you do anything besides just the damp moss?
No, I don't. Completely wash it off, keep it clean, and then I would spray it with a little Fizan so that I don't get any mold or something like that growth on it. For some really, really sad plants, that look like, you know, and they're really rare, and I have a back bulb, I would get like cakey grow paste. Normally it's, you know, used for a Phalaenopsis. If you know a Phalaenopsis, they put out, you know, the inflorescence, mm-hmm. and you could apply some of the paste at, on the nodes, and you get a plantlet. Well, the cakey grow has the, you know, gibberellic acid and some other hormones that initiate plant growth. So what I would do is, if it's a really, really sad plant, and it's a really rare plant, like, you know, I got maybe only this and this of it, and the back piece is really sad, I would clean it off, and then I would apply some of that cakey grow paste to the back end, some of the eyes. The eyes may be really tiny and shriveled, but if they're not black, they're still alive. So if there's little tiny, just, you know, vestiges of life there, I would apply some of the paste on it. And some of the cakey grow stuff has a little bit of, they're maybe mixed in with Bordeaux powder, which is, a fungicide or something like that, mixed in it. Now, once I have this thing repotted up, clean it up. Clean your plant up.
Yeah.
And I didn't mention that, but that's always a good thing to do. Clean up, take off the old sheath and clean up the plant, because what you want to inspect it for is insects. And the thing that really plagues these poor things are scale. And, you know, look carefully at the plant, make sure there's no scale on it.
Yes, the scale.
Scale is an insect, and a hard scale or soft scale, you know, it can sap the life. It can kill a plant if you let it go. So make sure that the plant is clean. And if you see scale, you know, what I do is simply just get a toothbrush and wash it off. And then I get a, you know, like this, of... Yeah, Visan, and spray the plant, and wash it off. And then it usually takes care of it. I try not to get the plants, or any of these plants, along where I'm gonna get a scale infestation. That's the one thing you gotta keep track of. And if you're growing these things outdoors, the biggest vector or the ants. Ants bring in scale. They bring in aphids too, but you know, the ants are the big farmers of these, you know, suck-sapping insects. So make sure you don't have an ant problem too. So if you're outdoors and you see ants, well, lay down some kind of insecticide for the ants. But keep the plant clean. And then what I do is I don't feed it. I don't put fertilizer in the plant. Right after we pot it, don't fertilize it. You know, what happens is fertilizer can actually burn too, you know. But when you start seeing active growth, meaning that you start seeing new growth going into the pot, then you can feed it. But when you're newly repotted, don't fertilize it. But keep it in a somewhat shady place. Don't give it full sun. Put it in a shady part of your greenhouse, your shade house, not full light, you know. Keep it slightly shaded and keep the humidity relatively high. So you can mist it. So a good misting every day, and keep the bark, keep the mix slightly on the dry side. Don't heavily water the plant. The best thing to do is keep it slightly dry, and this will actually promote growth, root growth. Overwatering will actually create rot. But if you keep it slightly on the dry side, you're gonna initiate root growth. And when you start seeing a full flush of roots, and once this thing starts going, you'll start seeing roots traveling across the surface of the bark, and you see it going into the mix. Once that happens, then you could start watering on your regular basis, and then start feeding it your regimen of fertilizer. This stuff, and fertilizers are based, you know, on numbers. NPK system, you know, phosphorus. Was it? Yeah, exactly. So 30-10-10 is the high nitrogen fertilizer. I just give it a balanced fertilizer. So the numbers are just, you know, 5-5-5, 10-10-10, you know, 20-20-20. I don't mix. I mean, people will do. They would go to the high nitrogen fertilizer, and then switch over to a lower nitrogen fertilizer. To me, it's too much trouble. I just give it a balanced fertilizer, and that's fine. But what I do, though, is that in the winter time, in the cooler months, I do start changing over to the lower nitrogen fertilizers. So the higher the potassium and calcium and phosphates, because the plant is not really putting out leaf growth. As the temperature cools and we start getting into autumn and start to winter, the plant's no longer really putting out this kind of growth, leaf growth and flower growth. It's really putting out more root growth. So the lower nitrogen fertilizers are better for root production and actually flower production later in the spring and the summer like that. So I cut down on the amount of, it's kind of like cymbidium feeding a little bit. And cymbidium feeding would do the same thing in the winter months or the cooler months. He would cut down on nitrogen.